This way, Ramona is only a 2-hour drive for me. See you guys in Ramona. I just have to decide which dog to take. I've been watching for so long that my puppies are grown dogs now. LOL.
So that'll be great to see you out there, Josue. The cool thing is you can like get a ticket now and then decide later which dog to bring. Because all of our seminars are probably going to sell out because we're cutting them down on size. They sold out when we had not unlimited, but when we were able to fit a lot of people in. But now with what's going on, we can only fit so many people into the rooms, even though like it's a bigger room. Next. Hey, we're live. How's everybody going? How's everybody doing?
Stopping by to give thanks. Continuing education for dog owners and trainers is mandatory and grateful.
Awesome. Dogs just stop doing bad shit. It's incredible. And then you get to start training your dog. Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. Hello, Joelle. How are you?
Good.
So this is a little Q&A show we do. What would Jeff do? We do it every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. This Friday, we will not be doing a show because we will be driving to Canton, Ohio for a fantastic seminar. You can go to Jeff Gellman Seminars.
I have to put my watermelon back in the
fridge. Okay, go ahead.
My dinner.
The watermelon can't. In your fridge? Just put it in this fridge here. Okay. So every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, we do a one-hour show from 7 to 8 p.m. And Jeff Gellman Seminars, you might want to check that out because Jeff Gellman Seminars, we actually do seminars around the world. And this coming weekend, we'll be in Canton, Ohio. And that's going to be a good one. It's a really good one. And you just go there and you buy your tickets right online. And they're problem-solving seminars. They're for challenging dogs. And this podcast we do, we tend to get a lot of people that are also asking questions about how to stop unwanted behaviors. So you're going to hear me talk a lot about the word punishment, and punishment is not abuse. It's been hijacked by some people that feel that it is. It's just the opposite of reward. So you only got a couple of things up your sleeve. You got a reward and you got punishment. And rewards make the dog do more of something, and punishment makes them stop or do less of something. And then we've got the training center here, which we're at right now.
Right now.
And that does 365 days a year, and it never closes. And so Joelle's going to ask a question. I'll answer it. You guys write it. And if you want to know how to do top chats, because people ask about top chats, it's only a YouTube thing. And you have to ask on YouTube. And then you, what happens is your question goes to the top of the queue, but you do not have to pay to play. We get through as many questions as we possibly can. So where do we start?
You should probably lock your phone so it doesn't drain your battery.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
All right, Melissa said good evening all. Happy Monday.
Hey, Melissa, how are you?
Tom, hi, guys.
Oh, hey.
Hi, Tom.
Hey, Tom.
Brianna, hey, guys. Hi, Brianna.
Hey, Brianna, how are you doing tonight?
Irene, good evening.
Hello, Irene.
David, hi, Jeff. Hi, Joelle.
Hello, David.
Hello, Alejandro. Hi, y'all.
Hey.
Melissa posted a link to Jeff Gellman Seminars.
Thank you.
Josue, hi guys. Any update on California seminars or anything nearby?
Yeah, we're doing one in, well, update, I mean, we're doing one in Ramona. So that's been on the calendar. That's one of the ones that didn't have to get postponed or changed the dates, and that's still there. And there's one in Ramona. That's probably the only.
Didn't you just do a new one though, somewhere northern?
Oh, it's San Jose.
San Jose.
So yeah, so thank you for reminding me about that. We just announced San Jose for 2021.
Yeah.
And we're doing Ramona in 2020.
We're practically
so,
at 2021 at this point.
Yeah, but there's still a good
2020's just done.
No, it's not.
Can this year just be over?
No, not yet. There's some good stuff.
Let's see. Josue, I helped my coworker with leash work using a prong. It felt so good to be able to help.
That's one of the best feelings in the world. I think that's why we do the work we do, because of helping people have a better life. So kudos to you.
Eric. Looking forward to this weekend.
Eric.
Get some more clickers from Eric.
Yep, we're looking forward to being there. Next.
Can't wait. Are we doing it the new?
Yeah, it's new one. Yeah, we switched facilities from his old one because the new one wasn't even up yet before when we announced the first one when we planned all this. So.
Vanessa, hi guys. I was wondering if you have a specific set of questions you ask people before they become possible clients. Also, just got my ticket to see you guys in December in Ramona.
For clients, yeah, I mean, we've got an application that we fill out, and
they fill
it out, and I can usually get a lot of information from them, but obviously then I call them. But also we put all of our information on our website as far as the prices, our tools, our philosophy, our methodology. So people, what they do is they sort of get a good idea of what we do, and that filters out some people that might not be the right client for us. And the biggest thing is this is the people business. So you have to make sure you've got really good people skills, and you want to be able to work with people, and you want to win-win. Like, you want the owner to win, not just you to win. Next.
Early.
Wow.
Jessica, hey.
Hey.
Tessa, hi. I'm easing my own Malinois, and I'm 12 years old. Thanks to your help, I don't need much of my mom's help anymore. JV is doing so well, and I love training her. You are so helpful. Raising my own Malinois.
Raising. Oh, good for you, Tessa. I'm proud of you. 12 years old, raising a dog, let alone a Malinois.
Yeah.
That's damn pretty cool. Awesome.
Louise, aloha, guys.
Hey, aloha to you. Man, we're going to go to Hawaii, but we just can't get there.
Rhonda, barking at people from your car, a verbal warning or a correction, both?
Usually, I would do no and then correct, so consequence after that. Your average dog just randomly barks at people, and a lot of people are like, well, what happens if I get carjacked? I'm like, well, carjackings are not as popular as they think in the United States, at least. So I'm more concerned about the annoying barking. Next.
Holding on dog training. Greetings from hot as fuck Florida. No questions tonight. Just love you guys and always look forward to these.
Oh, awesome. Love you too,
hot
Ashley.
Hot today here too.
Yeah.
I can't imagine what Florida was.
It was hot outside today.
Muggy.
Yeah. It's like in the 90s.
Haraz. Hi, Jeff. My GSD is very good on recall and plays outside, never leaving our lawn with me. Recently, he broke command, and in spite of many at 100, he bolted away after a dog. Do I need a stronger e-collar?
You might, or you just might have to up your recall. Just keep in mind, your timing could have been off, could have been bad collar fit. I mean, keep in mind that the mini educator is the lowest, the least strong of the brand. It goes from low to medium, where they do make some, like the Boss, that goes from low to high. But still, drive overrides discomfort often. That's why dogs blow through 100 on the remote, especially after prey. Next.
The noble dogs. Do you teach the dogs to go from down to sit? Should I teach it with food first, or go with leash and e-collar and finish off with food?
No, you would start it with food. So, because you're teaching. So, we don't, but it's easy enough to do puppy push-ups.
Yeah, we teach that.
So, you know, I mean, it's not a required thing, but
no.
You can do it with leash pressure, and then you walk into the dog. Like, you stand in front of the dog, and you sort of, like, a little bit of leash pressure up while you're using spatial pressure, and then when the dog starts doing that successfully, you'd give it a name, but you would start it with food, because that's how we start everything. Next.
Caroline, update. Wilson, the Jack Russell, is doing fantastic 2.5 years later. Thanks for saving his little life.
Oh, you're welcome. Well, thanks for doing all this. Thanks for doing all the hard work. Like, you're the one that did all the hard work. Next.
Josue, Ramona is only a 2-hour drive for me. See you guys in Ramona. I just have to decide which dog to take. I've been watching for so long that my puppies are grown dogs now. LOL.
So that'll be great to see you out there, Josue. The cool thing is you can, like, get a ticket now and then decide later which dog to bring. Because all of our seminars are probably going to sell out because we're cutting them down on size. They sold out when we had when we were able to fit a lot of people in. But now with what's going on, we can only fit so many people into the rooms, even though, like, it's a bigger room. Next.
Tessa, it's my mom's phone. I'm Jillian.
Oh, hey, Jillian.
Tiffany, hey, Jeff and Joelle. Love the show and always appreciate the wealth of knowledge of information you cover. Got a question regarding leash reactivity. My GSD mix has stayed at a reputable board and train with a balance trainer previously for 8 weeks. And while there, she did not exhibit any leash reactivity behavior. Once we got her back, it became apparent pretty quickly that her reactivity when with us was still there.
Yeah.
How would you go about remedying working on leash reactivity when it shows up only with us?
Yeah, so that's not uncommon to happen. And what I would do is call the place that you went to, and that's one of the things that you want to do. There's environmentals and associations. So there's a relationship and association. So the dog still feels around you that it needs to be reactive. and the trainers have a different relationship. We often have a dog that does great around us, like really great around us. And then everything from regresses a little bit to totally falls apart when the owner comes in. And that just because the relationship the dog has with the owner, it's the way the dog behaves. So you have to teach the owner what you're doing. You don't have to know, you know, like the thousands of hours of what you're doing, but they have got to like just teach them the skill set and how to fix it. And then go back up one question, who's using her. So Tessa or Jillian, are you using your mom's phone because your mom doesn't think you're old enough to have a phone? Well, the fact that you're raising your own Malinois, I think you're responsible enough if that's the situation. Unless yours is just low on batteries. Next.
Kionda, can I correct for arousal when we reach and grab the leashes to take them outside or when we go toward the door around the time they go to the bathroom? Mm. The sense start the whining and restlessness.
Yeah, actually, that's a great time to do it. That's when a bonker really, really comes in handy. So what happens is a lot of folks, what they'll do is it's common. I reach for the leash and I'm going for a walk. Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah, it's like pick up the chucking stick. I'm going for a walk. Lately, when Rachel's been walking in the office, the dogs are like, oh, we're going swimming.
Yeah.
Cause she's been taking them swimming. So it's just really, really funny that like people can walk in the office all day long and my dogs don't move. She walks in the office and they're like, oh, they go running towards her. It's like, oh, we're going swimming.
Yeah, but now Wes's leash means, oh, I have to get eardrops.
Right, right.
I'm creating a negative association.
So what I would do is I would talk to the training facility and just tell them that you're struggling and if they can help you a little bit more. Next.
Rhonda said thank you.
You're welcome.
Vanessa, any tips for getting a dog with no food drive to work for food besides a scheduled food schedule?
You know, so there's you got to use compulsion. You know, I mean, if a dog won't work for food, you still got to train it. So then you just have to use more leash pressure. I mean, we don't starve dogs, but you can just be like, the only way you're going to eat your meals is with food. With food. So if the dog's eating out of its bowl,
it sounds like she has it on a scheduled feeding. So I would.
So I would stop. I would literally only feed your dog through training. So you're still going to feed your dog like say 2 cups a day, but it's through training. So the dog's still eating the allotted food, but you do it through training. Next.
Louis, do you have any videos on recall training?
We do. It's up on our YouTube channel underneath probably recall training. Yeah.
Kayla, hello. Took dog to the outdoor mall and she couldn't hold a heel or stop sniffing or stimulated.
Yeah.
I felt like I was constantly correcting. Was I not correcting high enough or was she not ready?
I don't know. I don't know how much training you've done with the dog. I mean, what I would do is maybe go to the mall when it's outdoor. I know it's outdoors because we have a couple of those by us. Maybe go to it when there's no people there, like on the off hours. So there's less environmentals. Train then. And the sniffing you can definitely correct. And healing you can definitely correct. But chances are, yes, there was just too many environmentals. As far as you're not correcting high enough, if the dog didn't stop the behavior, then the answer to that is correct. Next.
Ernie, keep up the great work, you all. My dog has dealt with barrier frustration in the past, and we have worked hard on it. He's done so well for the past 3 years. Now new neighbors have 2 yippers and a lab that they just let them stand at the fence and bark and growl. It drives my dog nuts and I have to do some corrections. How can I help them understand how important this is for their and my dogs to stop? Thank you.
So the thing about this is, Ernie, is you really can't tell neighbors, well, in our neighborhood, you can't really tell neighbors what to do. So what you do is you've got to just work on your own dog not responding to them, and eventually what will happen most likely is those dogs will just shut up because it's not fun anymore, and your dog is definitely capable of just ignoring them, because we've got barking dogs all around our house, but our dogs are not allowed to respond. It's like, if you want to be a jerk, go ahead and bark, but I'm not going to. Next.
Kirsten, my 16-week-old puppy makes some pretty aggressive sounds while playing with my older two. Mm-hmm. Just let it be, as it doesn't seem to bother them and they don't correct her for it.
Yeah, I mean, dogs playing make lots of aggressive noises and they act aggressively, but they're not aggressive. So, like your average dog, like on a serious dog fight, like dogs will grab each other by the throat. And meanwhile, a good example is like Joelle's two dogs, ironically, Wes, who's the dominant dog, is often having his throat grabbed by Bert, and Wes is on the ground, and Bert is like grabbing his throat and like shaking it, and and Wes thinks it's the funniest thing in the world. And if Wes was to go and fight a dog, like that's the move he would make. Maybe he's learning. Like he's like going, Bert, will you teach?
Yeah, exactly. Me? It's like practice for the real shit, you know.
But he's like, you know, in jiu-jitsu, he's like, you know.
Yeah, they're just grappling.
Yeah.
Practicing.
Yeah, exactly.
It is funny when they do that, not gonna lie. Melissa posts a link to virtual one-on-ones with you.
Oh, thank you.
Uh-oh, I got fun. Here we go. Christine. Training a client's cane corso, walking on trail, did well till the dog passing by exploded. Client's dog redirected on me. Didn't bite, but up on back legs, pawing at me, put mouth on my wrist.
Yeah. So, I mean, if the corso wanted to harm you, it absolutely could. That's a big, powerful dog. So what I would do is, it's hard to role play that because then you got to find a dog that's going to be exploding. But if you can find a dog that's barking like through a fence, and teach the dog how to walk past it. I mean, the first thing you could have done is just literally slam the leash in a downward motion, So what I would do is I would do that. And then you have to find a dog. It's hard sometimes to find leash reactive dogs, but if you go into some like enough bike paths and dog walking areas, there's always dogs that do that. And then teach the dog some good fundamental heel, make sure it knows a proper heel, even around no distractions and then small distractions and then big distractions. Role play it as much as you can and then take it out into the real world and then make sure your timing and your corrections is proper. So at the first sign that you see the dog being aroused, you would correct the dog. As far as the redirection is concerned, like I was going to think to myself that like, oh, muzzle it up, but the dog just grabbed your wrist. So it just, you can still put a muzzle on it, but I mean, a corso can put a serious bite on you and it didn't. Next.
Alexandria, good afternoon. I just want to ask you guys, what is your perspective on putting dogs down that are getting old? I have a Cocker Spaniel that is blind. Pretty sure he's going deaf at times. We have to take him outside so he goes. He's not incontinent yet. And we have to bring him by his food for him to eat. All my family is telling me that he needs to be at rest, but he's part of the family. He's our baby, and I'm not sure if we're ready yet, but would like to do the right thing.
So, you know, that's a very, very, very personal choice. I think quality of life of the dog is important. I think if you speak to enough vets, most of them will say that most owners wait too long. They wait too long. So, I mean, sometimes a dog just dies in its sleep, It's like, geez, you were okay today and you just died in your sleep. Or I know you were getting old, but you just died in your sleep. So then you've got dogs who slowly, some people want to keep dogs alive to the last breath. And I get it. I mean, I understand. But I think at some point, you've got to be like, your quality of life is not good. Like, it's not good. And I mean, that's why they call it humane euthanasia. And people can say, well, you're killing the dog. There's nothing humane about it. But the way it's done is pretty humane because the dog is sedated and then put to sleep and it doesn't really know that it's dying, obviously. I don't know, I've never, you know, it's no different than, it's like one step farther than being put to sedated to going in for surgery. So that's a really personal choice. I wouldn't listen to what your friends tell you. You can always talk to your vet about it. I don't think vets are in any rush to put down dogs, you know, so I think you should, you could talk to your vet about it. And then I think you should just think about the quality of life of the dog. And it might be okay now, but, you know, a month from now, it might get really worse. And I think at some point, though, there's a time.
Megan, Hello, very glad you guys are getting to do seminars again. That is such a good format for helping a lot of people fast.
Yeah, thanks, Megan. Yeah, I'm really enjoying them as well. The ones we've had, even with like the limited amount of people we can have and the extra health and safety things we've had to do. I'm really enjoying getting back into the flow. I'm terribly missing the hugs, you know, of the
smiling faces,
men and the women that go to them.
Masks
and
really throw me off.
Yeah, but I think the fact that we're helping people and getting really great results and getting some really great feedback, I think makes a lot of difference. Next.
Abandoned entity. I've been trying to get my dog into a state of indifference whenever we come across a reactive barking dog. He's in a heel, but his head drops and he begins to lag behind. What are things I can do to get him to that mindset of just not caring, being concerned? I've been trying to keep the momentum going, but it doesn't seem to put a dent in it.
Well, but hold on, abandoned entity. He's in a heel, but his head drops and he begins to lag behind. But so that's better than the alternative. And I think we've talked about some people.
I think he used to be reactive. Too,
right. So I'll take that for now. And then what you can do is try to I'll take that for now. But if you want to start trying to use a little bit of a leash pop or remote collar stim to get that dog to move in a little bit closer to you. But I would prefer that to the alternative for now. Next.
Rhonda, how long does a dog need to wear the prong collar on the average?
Well, most people use a prong collar at a minimum on the walks. And I'm in no rush to get dogs off of equipment. So to me, it's a lifestyle choice. And a lot of people will say, well, if the dog has to wear a prong collar, then it's not trained. And I'm like, well, I would disagree with that because there's many dogs that pull on prong collars. There's many people that get knocked over on prong collars. So there's many dogs that don't listen on a prong collar. So a prong collar is just a piece of the training tool that still you have to communicate the training to the dog. Some dogs, it's like night and day. You put it on and you have great walks. Mm. But I'm in no rush to get dogs off a prong collar. So with my dogs who can off-leash heel and I can walk them on a slip lead, but when we go for a walk, I put them on prongs. Why? They have to have a collar on because it's the law here. But even though they're off leash 95% of their life, and the leash has to be attached to a collar. So why not be a collar that easily goes on the dog and has dramatic effects if needed? Next.
Lucy, is there anything I can do beyond correcting with e-collar to help my dog be calm when I leave the house? She knows that she isn't allowed to bark and be destructive, but she still lies there, petrified, shaking, and panicking.
What I would do, Lucy, is I would start role-playing the whole lying down in the crate calmly when you are home. It's not the same as when you're not. That's why it's separation anxiety. So it sounds like you've got a camera on your dog, which it's like a catch-22. It's like, I want to make sure my dog's behaving, but meanwhile, I'm staring at my dog shaking, and it really upsets me, and I don't want to look at my dog shaking either, and I understand. So I think that what you want to do is practice a lot of duration work around a lot of environmentals when you are around, and start patterning that and patterning that and patterning that. Practice going in the crate and lying down when you are around or in the house, and start patterning that and patterning that and patterning that. Next.
Tessa, I'm grounded from it for now. I do have a really nice one. JV is more important though.
Okay, got it.
I also don't have Facebook, just Instagram.
Okay, well, you probably, yeah, and be careful. So
Jillian,
please be careful on Instagram.
Yeah.
Okay, that is a pedophile's stalking ground. So please be careful.
Any social media.
Yeah.
Days.
So please be very, 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 very careful. And I'm sure you already know this, but if it's the kind of thing where it's like, if someone's trying to make let's make this conversation between just the two of us and don't tell anyone else about it, that's like, tell somebody about it. Right?
Because you're getting into Papa Jeff mode.
Because nobody should be, inappropriate with you. And 12-year-old is unfortunately a prime age for sexual predators. So please be careful. Next.
Jessica, 7 month walking great. Then when passing a dog across the street, the other dog is going crazy barking. So my dog gets fearful and tucks in and starts to hurry even though I'm walking past, not stopping.
Right.
How to get her through it and not so uncomfortable.
So let's do this. Let's pretend your dog's not afraid. Let's just pretend it's not afraid. And let's just reframe that and go, my dog breaks heel when there's a barking dog. So I am going to enforce the heel. And I'm sorry that you're nervous. I can't tell you not to be nervous. Well, you could, but don't say that, because all the dog here is will hear is blah, 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 probably in a pleasant voice, which means you're doing a great job. So what I would do is I would just be like, you're not breaking heel. I mean, you are breaking heel. Let me put you back into a heel. So you can correct even a fearful dog if it breaks positioning. Next.
Mish, my dog's heel position is just in front of my knee with a loose leash. Is that okay, or should she be behind my knee?
So we prefer behind the knee, but Mish, that's us. How are your walks going? If your walks are fine and the leash is loose and the dog's not reactive and you're enjoying your walks, then leave it alone. Next.
Melissa, I have a male dog who squats when he pees, and he always pees on his front legs. Is it possible to teach him to not pee on his legs? LOL.
So when you find out,
let me know.
Let Joelle know, because Wes is the king of leg pissing.
So disgusting.
He, and some days he switches it up, but it's historically his front right paw.
You know what? He recently started lifting his leg, which he's never done. And he still pisses on himself because he doesn't lift it high enough.
And for some,
it's like a half raise.
And for some weird reason, he always pisses downhill.
Yes, so, he does.
So the piss.
I think it's the angle of his penis, honestly.
Well,
it's kind of big. It's just like.
That's what she said. So, I mean, it's right there, right between his
legs. Yeah, I feel like he's like structurally, right, he can't avoid it.
I think he could.
Yeah, he kept it perfectly straight and his paws were wider.
I think he's got to spread his legs a little bit more.
Yeah, I just don't think
you know,
he can.
I mean, I think he should, you know, his mother gave him that bad advice, like, keep your legs closed. But I think in this particular instant, the legs need to go.
I don't think there's ever been a day where, like, if it's in grass with soil, he's good because it's just absorbed.
Correct.
But concrete.
On concrete, it's so funny because he'll piss and then he'll be like, come inside. And I'm like, there's piss on your feet and you're tracking it inside most likely.
Yeah.
And it's disgusting.
Very disgusting.
Next.
Purple Shoes. What's your website?
It's the name of our
Melissa posted it.
A solid canine training. So it looks like that's a Periscope question. Our website, there's a link right in our bio on Periscope. Next.
Jessica, I stay neutral and don't say anything. Stay confident. Oh, when her dog starts breaking heel and getting nervous.
Okay, so you couldn't be proactive though. Next.
Ernie, as always, you make perfect sense. Thank you for what you do.
Oh, you're welcome.
It's Billy D. My dog is 8 and diabetic and recently lost his vision. Is there anything I can do to help him?
Well, supposedly there's ways to, you know, I mean, imagine, I don't know as far as like help him for what? See again? Like, I don't know, you know. I think there's people out there that claim that they can bring the sight back. But
really?
Sure. All kinds of like preachers and stuff and make you walk and get your vision back and stuff like that. But keep it.
Dogs don't even use their eyes.
Keep in mind that their eyes are like one of the last things they use. I mean, we'll have dogs that will, you can tell they're using their nose because they'll like walk right past a chuck it ball. It's like,
yeah,
you're using your nose to find it, but you like walked right past it.
Literally, it'll be right there. And they're like,
yes. So obviously the scent cone hasn't gotten there yet. So, but what you can start doing is setting up different scents around your house. Get like essential oils and like put them like their dog bed. Put the essential oil by their dog bed. And like if your dog was going outside in the backyard and you want to make sure it can find the back door, you can always set up like a fan on the inside so it like feels blowing air. Or you can also do essential oils there.
Smart.
I've walked my dogs into pitch black rooms and they've done fine. So, but that's not the difference, but they still have their sights. So but they definitely use their eyes last. Next.
Tessa, I also, okay, but it's Jillian though. So Jillian, I also have been very busy with training with her to do agility and go into competition. I'm also training her to be my service dog, so my plate is very full.
So no time for predators. That's good to know.
Purple shoes at prongs work.
Yes, they do.
Carlos, what is your best advice for dog training treats?
Oh, I don't know. We use the dog's daily food, and we also have some dried hot dog, and then we cut up ourselves and just dehydrate ourselves. And then we've got dried beef liver we use. But most of the time, the dogs work for their dog. Since we food train the dogs, we work with the dog's food.
Kibble. $4.99 top chat from the Noble Dogs. How do you e-call or train a dog who rarely makes mistakes and will do and hold command until released?
So what you want to do is you wouldn't need to use the e-call. You would use the e-collar to train the dog, but then if there's no opportunity to correct it, you can start doing something called proofing, which sometimes looks like you're teasing the dog. But if you've got a defined command and a confined break, then even if you like bent down and did kissy noises, and even if you said the dog's name and it broke command, you can correct it. Roll a ball, bounce a ball, skateboard, things like that. So that's what you're gonna do. But at some point you need to teach the dog what happens if it breaks command, or else it'll be lost if it ever does. Next.
Eileen, is it agreed? Purple shoes, my dog is trained, but he works better on a prong.
Yeah. I think it's a great tool. And it's like, people don't ask that about like martingales, choke chains, flat buckle. People don't ask that about like harnesses.
Right.
It's like, I just think like, let's just make the walk nice, stress-free for both of us. Next.
Rhonda said thanks.
You're welcome.
Abandoned entity. Surprisingly, he's never been reactive. He used to be way more fearful and would drop to the ground like a sack of potatoes. So we made great progress as far as that goes.
That's the dog that sluggish behind. So you're making progress. So sometimes progress is quicker than others, but you're making progress, and it's maybe just on a.
Will he take food?
A different slope. What you can do is, if he's food driven, you can get food and then put it like down by your side of your body and get the dog to come up into a better position. Next.
Ava Taglia. Hey, JJ, took the Dalmatians on two camping trips. They're doing awesome lying on place when we weren't out hiking and swimming.
Awesome. That sounds like a great weekend. Yeah. Awesome.
Abandoned entity for a little while. I got him just not caring, but we had several dogs come up to us off leash, yeah, and he got back into a weird, ugly place of being excited and then slightly fearful.
Yeah, it's a little bit, having an off-leash dog rush you sort of, or can totally mess up the dog big time, especially if they're attacked. But even just rushing you and sort of doing nothing, it freaks out a lot of dogs. So what I would do is just remember that you can get that back. You can get that back. Next.
Lori, my 11-month-old dog is new to the prong collar, and I'm working on basic obedience. My question is, do I use the prong collar pressure to teach him to bring the ball back when I throw it? He runs to get it, but won't bring it back, and will run away if I want him to come so we can go in the house. I'm thinking I need to get the remote collar.
Well, you would still start the dog on long line and prong collar. So make sure the dog has a good recall, and then most dogs with ball drive are pretty eager to bring the dog back. The ball back, because you're the one throwing the ball. So I think you just need to up your game on your recall training, but we start that on a leash and a training collar. Now you can also do it on a leash and a remote collar, but you definitely want to have a long line on the dog, because this concept that like my dog doesn't come back to me, so if I just give it a correction with a remote collar, it's going to come running back. It always doesn't work that way. Next.
Ava Taglia, bringing home a new foster soon who humps, marking and correcting, coming to a theater near you. Thank you for putting out so much great info on Patreon, your outlets. You both rock.
You're welcome. Yeah. So humping is relatively simple to stop. Marking, you got to be there to catch it, especially in the house. So next.
Tessa, thanks for talking to my beautiful kiddo. She needed to hear that from you. We watched this together, and the school we go to is very impressed with her timing on markers, which your Patreon content taught her.
Oh, so now this is back to Tessa.
This is Tessa now. Oh, that's awesome.
So it sounds like your daughter Jillian is doing a great job, Tessa.
Jessica, thank you, Jeff. Exactly, and we'll continue exactly that. Just pop the leash and let's go.
Yeah, sometimes that's just like a good overall attitude to have. It's just like, let's go.
Nothing to see here.
Yep.
Balanced bloodhounds. Both of our male dogs usually peed on their front legs. I just have small towels and vinegar water solution squirt bottle by the door to wipe whenever we go back inside. Interesting.
That's really, really good. So then we should probably keep one of those bottles.
Probably should.
Front door.
Melissa said, haha, darn it. And he's white, so his legs turn yellow and he stinks. Ugh.
That's pretty gross.
Wes at least grooms himself.
I think
that's why I don't let him.
I think smelling like piss is one of the things that you try to avoid.
Yeah.
Dogs don't seem to mind, though.
Wes cleans himself up.
Yeah, but you think he does it because it's like...
Because he's like, this is disgusting. He'll be licking instead.
So, yeah, exactly.
That's why I don't get... As my dogs do not kiss me.
Yeah, that's why. Well, nobody kisses you. So, I mean, I think that if he thought it was that gross, would he really lick off the piss off his legs?
True. I don't think he cares. He stares at you while he's doing it. You notice that? He's like, pissing on my leg right now.
You think he's like,
whole time, direct eye contact.
You think he's like waiting for a tip?
Maybe.
Like, hey, I'm giving myself a golden shower. Like, when did the tip start? It's like, okay. Like,
and then Bert is just like the most efficient pisser ever.
Yeah.
Hikes his leg up. Boom. Done.
I know. You know where Wes has been lifting his leg a lot is on the bucket. Right at the entrance.
They all pee there. It's disgusting.
It's the pee bucket. Thank God they don't get it inside the bucket.
Yeah.
That would be a
I don't think any of them can shoot their pee that high.
The bucket full of piss. Next.
It's Billy D, so thank you. Gretchen, hi guys.
Hey, Gretch.
Uh-oh. Here we go. Christopher, tips for getting my dogs to stop going in the trash. I've bonked 2 to 3 different times when he was caught with his head in the trash, but still finds a way to get into it when we aren't home. Even though it's under the kitchen sink, any tips on how my dog seems to anticipate the bonk when I say no and he sees the bonker who usually step back or dodge it?
So there's a couple of things you can do, Christopher. Number one, I mean, crating your dog up when you're not home is probably the safest thing you can do. Because if your dog gets in the trash, and I mean, there's stuff in the trash that can kill your dog. Definitely. Make your dog, at a minimum, give it diarrhea. But they also make kid locks. You know, the kid, it's like a, looks like a sliding thing. It's
yeah,
made
like
for
baby proofing.
Yeah, you're baby proofing your doors. If you've got doors on the, you know, under the sink. So then you can do that. The thing is, when there's nobody there to enforce the rules, you can also, I mean, there's what you can do is you can set up a little laser alarm that goes off. So when the dog crosses the laser alarm, it makes, like, right by the trash, it makes a noise. And then it gets a bonk and it stops. And then when you leave the house, you can just set up a little bit of the laser alarm if you want to. So when it hears the laser alarm, it's like, oh, shit, I'm supposed to stay away from that. Next.
Bruce, hey, you guys, how are you? Got a GSD coming this week that recently killed a poodle that it lived with for more than a year. How should I look? What should I look for in that evaluation?
I'd probably look to make sure you got no other poodles in the room. Like, that's a good place to start. I mean, like, the evaluation is, like, we know it's a dog killer, right? So I'm not quite sure what you're going to get from the evaluation. I mean, you sort of already have all the information. Like, you kill dogs. Was it GSD?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, you also have a huge size difference there. So it doesn't depends what size poodle it was.
They've got, like, poodles can be pretty big.
Yeah, I mean, if it's a, you know, I mean, your dog killed another dog, so you're bringing in a dog killer. So the evaluation really, I mean, for us, we wouldn't need to really do one. The evaluation is more of the humans. Are they ready to follow through with the protocols that you're going to set up to make sure that the training sticks? Next.
Sue, how can you handle a dog that walks well on leash until some unknown thing scares him to death? can't predict what will do it. Sometimes a sound or light or smell.
Yeah, I mean, like getting your dog social. When we sit here about talk about socialization, people think it's supposed to meet dogs and it's supposed to meet people. It's actually just supposed to meet the world. Different sights, different sounds, different textures that they're walking on, different situations, and never interacting with those things. Just, well, I guess you would interact with the ground if you're on like walking on like grass, but as far as like the people and dogs, but just existing around them and getting your dog used to them. So the information that your dog is getting is, oh, everything is okay. It's no big deal. But then there's always those what ifs.
I think that's why we like the training videos we show, you know, these dogs walking through bottle pools or like those 5-gallon water things like rolling on the floor.
Yeah.
People are probably like, what is the point of that? But it's like, it just desensitizes them to like a lot of
sudden sounds too. Yeah.
Balanced bloodhounds. I think you have said that you could start a puppy with a prong around 14 weeks. Is that right? For bloodhound, would you start with a smaller prong than what you would end up with as an adult?
Yeah, usually with that's why they make the 2.25 millimeter ones. Yep.
Abandoned entity. I appreciate the feedback. It was a little disheartening to move backwards, but like you said, there's always the fact that it can go back to good.
Yeah.
To a good place.
Yeah, I'm tired too tonight.
Yeah, I've had a slam a headache all
day. Yeah.
I don't think I drank enough water.
Yep.
Paraz gave my extra prong to a neighbor with a jumpy Bernedoodle, and in one lap it was changed. My GSD will still pull on his prong at times, though. Can it be they just get used to it after a while?
Dogs can definitely get overly or desensitized to the prong, but that's why we want dogs to walk behind us, because it's almost like you're nagging your dog. So what we tell people is like, stop nagging your dog, and actually correct the dog properly. Next.
Tessa said camera setup for the trash scammers.
Yeah. The thing is though, you gotta be home for that.
Yeah.
That's the thing. You gotta be home for that.
Next. Jessica was talking with my dad that had an Australian Shepherd for 15 years, and I remember it being such a great dog. Of course my dad plays no games, and he told me I had training videos and that use the prong.
Yeah. Yeah, prongs are not new. Correcting your dog is not a new concept. It became in the 60s, early 70s, it started becoming more and more taboo. I think social media sort of escalated that up to get a lot of the folks from an ideology of never say no to your dog that really pushed that agenda. But I think dogs were better behaved 35, 40 years ago because people were like, well, of course I correct my dog for doing something wrong. Like, why wouldn't I?
Yeah, they weren't like...
It's like, what's the big deal? Yeah, but now everything is... Humans are a pretty sensitive lot now. And they tend to take on the emotional baggage of what their dog may be feeling. Next.
Vicky, oddly enough, there's a daycare dog, Sheepadoodle, that has peed straight into the mop bucket we used to clean up pee with. I wasn't sure if I should be grossed out or amazed, LOL.
That's some skill. I mean... Having a dog back up to a mop bucket and taking a shit in one,
right?
That's pretty skillful. I think someone told us that once that worked at a daycare.
I've seen dogs here shit on our fence. You know, like the very bottom wooden thing that like braces the bottom of the fence.
Which fence?
The 8-foot one.
Uh-huh.
They shit on it, so it's on the ledge.
Oh, really?
Of the wooden fence. Like, you had to shit there. I had to, like, scrape it off.
It's like...
On the fence.
Or maybe they feel their shit is so spectacular.
Can't be on the ground.
It deserves, like, almost like... You know how you, like, put trophies up on a shelf?
Yeah, like, exactly.
It's like, this shit is fucking trophy quality. I'm going to put it...
On a shelf.
On a shelf. And
it was impressive. I watched it happen. Right. I'm like, wow.
Do they turn around and look at it?
No.
They just walk away.
Walk away.
It's pretty confident. It's like, I don't need to look at my shit. I know it on the fence. Huh.
Yeah.
Next.
Very impressive. Melissa posted the link to my Patreon channel.
Oh, that's nice of you, Melissa. Thank you.
Jessica, and I hold them accountable in a loud affection at certain times. I was like, just like Solid Canine, ha, can't believe I almost got sucked up in all positive training for snowflakes. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I get it. I mean, we use a positive training when we train a command, but I think they're doing a really good job of scaring the shit out of owners. Mm. Like when you say that anything but a reward is abuse, I mean, it sort of stops you cold in your tracks, you know. And when you, or if they say, if you correct your dog, you'll ruin the relationship.
Yep.
I mean, they use a lot of trigger words that make you go, man, if I do this, then I don't want to mess a dog, you know. So it sort of scares you when it's, we see the opposite actually. Next.
Jessica, when looking to get a puppy, how do you find breeders that do temperament testing? Is that necessary?
I don't know, actually. I don't know. I don't know much about the breeding world and how to pick out a puppy. That's not what I do. It's not my specialty. It's not even my minimum base of knowledge. So I would find a good breeder, which, how do you do that? But, or somebody that knows how to pick out a good puppy and be like, this is what I'm looking for. Next.
Barista boy. I introduced one piece of structure every few months to my dog in the house. I feel like if I had waited and introduced all of them at once, I would have noticed a bigger difference. Do you think dogs can build a tolerance to structure?
I think that, I mean, this is the thing though, barista. Like,
what does that mean, build a tolerance?
I'm not quite sure, but let's go with the first half of it, and I think that it's like you can just make everything structured.
Everything.
Yeah,
everything's gonna be on a schedule.
Yeah, next.
$5 top chat. Best behaved pups, dog training. Hi, J&J. My dog Max always poops in a bush or the woods. So considerate.
That you know, in the bushes.
Bert does that too.
Is, oh yeah.
He's very like particular about where he poops.
Yeah, no shit. I mean, yes, shit. Yeah. He used to go across the street.
The only place he'd go.
And he'd be like, I'm gonna take a shit here. It's out of the way. It's not like in foot where foot traffic is. It's like a car's not going to roll over it, and like there's shit in the tire. And it's, if there's any nasty smell, it's probably not going to waft back into, like, I even think he checks for wind direction. He's really considerate. He's like, my owner's standing to the east and it's northern wind. I think I'll shit here. And so it's a northwestern wind. And so like the smell will go away from you or from me. So he's one of the most considerable shitters I think I've ever met. In fact, when he farts, he actually says, excuse me, which he's got really good. He's got good bowel habits. I mean, I'm pretty impressed by them actually. Next.
Trish, what are the biggest things to look for determining at what point an aggressive dog is deemed to be beyond the point of being rehabilitated? What has your experience been with dogs like that?
Well, I think that a lot to do is like, what's the experience of the trainer and the rehabilitation skills? And then did you confer with any colleagues that also have rehabilitation skills? But then you also have to think about like, the owner. Like, just because the dog can be really good around you but not around the owner, but you're not going to keep the dog, the owner has to. And then you think, well, maybe we lived with another family. I'm like, but is that the ethical thing to do, you know, with another family? So I think you've got to be really careful with that decision. But I think if we can't get a dog to be safe enough, you know, then we're always gonna let the owner know like where the dog is. It's like, this is where your dog is and this is where we feel comfortable. But then you have to also see how they are with the dog, and then it's important that they realize that like your dog, even though it's gone through training, has got certain limitations.
Yeah,
I think that's what's really, really important.
Be a lot of, like, I feel like even with some of our most successful rehabs, it's like we always are like, there's still going to be management. Like,
yeah.
You know what your dog's capable of.
At least for a while. Mm-hmm. I think that's what also people have to realize. It's like, just think about rehab. It's like, we're going to take the dog on this journey. You know, it's like, well, what's it going to be like in 6 months if we keep up with the training? a year if we keep up with the training. So next.
Bruce,
I'm exhausted.
Bruce said, thanks you guys. I appreciate the help. Spoken extensively with the owners and they are on board and engaged for a behavior mod program and they understand what's involved. Thanks.
Oh, that's all. That's good.
Grease the boy. Like, if you have an out-of-control dog and then send them to your training center, in one day they will have a different mind because of the structure, whereas I read about only pieces. Waiting at the door, waiting for food, kennel drills, healing, calm in the house, not being on the furniture. And since I did that over so much time, he just bounced back from each one.
Okay, I mean, we're not going to do everything like you mentioned in one day. I mean, every day will be structured, though. It just,
our biggest thing is, like, quiet in the crate.
Yep.
Waiting at thresholds.
Yep, those two are big.
Those are real big.
And going in the crate.
Going in the crate.
Going in the crate. Nicely. And then coming out nicely. And I think by doing those things, I think what you do is you get a dog that has a different state of mind. But even though you spread it out, I don't know if that's what the tolerance thing is. In other words, like your dog shouldn't lose what it learned.
Right.
Next.
Tessa, my kid is rolling this episode. Pee, poop, and predators.
Yeah, the three P's. It's always good to remember those.
Always. Perez, my DSC only relieves himself at the corner park. Had to train him that way to save my and the neighbor's grass.
Yeah.
Though he's a squatter too, LOL. But at least I don't have to take him to tree to tree when...
Yeah, I mean, male dogs that squat are pretty damn cool if you ask me.
I feel like that's, like, common. I don't know. We have a lot of board and trains that do.
You know what? I definitely have noticed not as many leg lifters as before.
And even Bert is, like, 50-50. Sometimes he
does not do, like, I don't even know if he hits 45-degree angle. He ain't doing no 90s, that's for sure.
No. Those are, like, obnoxious.
Well, some dogs do a full 90.
Their leg up so high.
Some dogs.
They're going to, like, tip over.
Then you get some of those dogs that, like, used to, like, are you trying out for Cirque du Soleil?
And then nothing comes out. They're just marking.
But you get these dogs that are, like, Cirque du Soleil. It's, like, they're, like, going.
It's, like, I wish I had that hip mobility.
They're, like, going past. It's, like.
I wish I had that.
Are you trying to freaking hit the sky? Like, geez Louise, where did you get those skills from?
My hips would snap in half.
Next.
That's it right now.
Yeah. Huh. I didn't even go on any rants. Actually,
that's probably why we actually got through all the questions.
I actually tried to slow down my cadence tonight too of the questions.
We didn't go on any rants tonight. That's why though. Normally we go on at least one or two. But it's good. We got
There was nothing.
Lately we haven't been getting through them.
No, outwardly extensive laughter from you.
This was a calm show.
This was a really calm show.
We're capable of being calm.
Maybe it's, well, we're capable of being exhausted in doing a show.
I took like this weird nap today. It just threw me all off. I was like, I had a headache. I'm like, all right, I'm just going to lay down. And then I woke up in an alternate universe. I'm like, how did that happen?
Did the universe have a name?
No, I just had a worse headache. This is why I don't take naps. And I had a worse headache. And I felt terrible.
Maybe need more water.
I think I need a drink more water.
Yeah. Next.
Purple Shoes said, my dog is a squatter, a very clean one.
Nice. That's always nice. But even though squatting, if you're angled like on a hill, and if you're squatting downhill, the pee can come right back at your back legs. That's happened to girl before.
Yeah.
That's happened to girl before. So you gotta watch it. You gotta watch out for that. And that's on cement again. Like our dogs.
Cement is the worst.
Most of our dogs go to the bathroom on cement. Because we don't really have any grass. Except for that grass that they eat outside.
So
what is
weird.
Up with that?
Barista Boy said that makes sense. Sid, hi guys. Sid, you are so late to the show. But hi.
Did Sid just show up?
I think so. He said hi guys.
Oh, hey Sid.
Balance Bloodhounds, you guys can also do calm on command. Like us personally.
Oh, us personally. Yeah, I think that,
I'm
you know.
A calm human being most of the time.
Yeah, I mean, this is sort of like my normal. This is my normal. Like everything else is, I don't want to say it's an act, but it's like
we try to make you guys laugh.
But we have to be up and fun, and
yeah.
Nobody wants to listen to. I think this show's been pretty monotone, and
I know. I'm like, are there gonna be any good clips from the show?
Probably not. But we don't do the show for the clip. We do the show for the information, and usually it ends up being a clip. You know. So next.
Vicky, today's the poop talk show. LOL.
Yeah, we seem to be poop and pee.
About a lot of poop.
And pee. Pretty much that and healing. Not a lot of other questions other than that.
Well, summer. Everybody's getting outside.
Yeah, but we didn't have to talk about correcting it. We just talked about it.
Mm-hmm. Tessa, if you have time, tell us about people who ask to pet your dog and how you respond.
So usually, if they ask, I will say, thank you for asking, but no. If they don't ask, then I'm rude. I will be like, don't pet my dog. And I say it with a lot of force. I say it with a lot of force. So I'm just pretty adamant about people not petting my dog. So I don't make it in a suggestive tone. I make it in a commanding tone without yelling. But I think it's all just about boundaries. I think some people are uncomfortable with telling somebody they can't pet their dog because they feel bad about it. But the thing is that people pet other people's dogs for their own selfish needs. I think that's what, every time I make a statement like that, a lot of things I say people disagree with, but it's like, oh no, they really like dogs. I'm like, no, it makes them happy to pet your dog. They're doing it for themselves.
Correct.
They're doing it for themselves. Because if I told them that my dog doesn't want to be petted, say, they would still insist on doing it.
And I think that's why now people are so uncomfortable, because of the backlash they get. It's like you tell people, no, you can't, and then they're called jerk. Oh, you're a jerk. You won't let me pet your dog.
I have heard some vile stuff being thrown, especially
out on the Home Depot one day.
It's like, I just said, no, you can't pet. It's like, what, you haven't heard no before? It's like, sorry, you can't pet my dog.
Right.
It's like, it's my dog.
I actually had a pleasant encounter with someone at Whole Foods. I had Little Blue with me, and everybody loves Little Blue. And this guy runs up, and I'm like, oh no. And he's like, your dog is so cute. I'm like, please don't pet him. He's like, okay, no, I totally get it. Yep. I just want to let you know your dog was really cute. I'm like, wow, first time ever someone is like nice
to you.
Purple Shoes only pees on grass, won't pee at the airport pee place.
Yeah, and I don't blame them.
Yeah, that's tough.
That's weird. It's
weird
not,
and smelly.
Yeah, but most airports now have got this underground cleaning system underneath the grass.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's usually underground. Yeah, it's built in. It's actually up on a raised platform, so the pee goes through it, and then there's usually sometimes they've got a hose on the side that they can wash it all down. But I think some dogs struggle with that. But, I mean, if a dog's got to go, it's got to go.
Sid was at the vets with Reggie, cone off.
Nice.
Balanced bloodhounds. The hard thing for people, performers, is being excited or fun on command. My husband struggles with that while teaching.
I can do that. I can definitely
turn on. You're really good at doing that.
I can turn on. Definitely be like, let's go. It's the Jeff show. But I think I've been tired for the last couple of years.
Since I've known you.
But I think today's been just training. A lot going on. Next.
Jessica, my dog lifts her whole back body once she feels the pee. Ha, ninja, runs back to the walk.
Wow.
Wow. Picks her legs up and she's on just her front teeth.
I've seen two dogs, I'm sure there's a lot, that actually will climb up a tree, and they'll not climb up the tree. Their back legs will go up a tree and they'll shit on the tree.
Yeah.
It's like that was their poop routine. It's like, that's a weird, but they sort of push their butt into the tree.
Right.
It's like, wow.
That was like the dog with the fence here.
It's
like effort. That's a lot of effort.
I think it comes nat. It's like nobody taught them that, I don't think.
No. I'm trying to think who the heck that even was. It was definitely a board and train, but I
can't. You think that they learn that? Like, do they learn that somewhere? Do they I don't know. It's like, remember there was a time when all these kids were eating the Tide Pods? It's like, you think they hang out with their buddies and they'd be like, hey,
can you poop on that platform?
Shitting on trees is the cool thing to do. And they said, well, I'm going to just try it next time. And then they tried it and they really liked it.
Maybe.
I wonder if they did that.
Next. Nikamitsu, how to know when dogs who can exist around each other are ready to interact off leash together?
So I think that's a good question. I think existence is step one. For us, it comes with experience, and you just have a feeling. It's like, okay, we drop the leash and let it drag, and then eventually the leash comes off, and a lot of it's by just understanding like the intent of the dog and being able to read some, you know, it's not all body language, because some dogs don't give, they're awkward, but you have to just give, it's a sense of feeling. Next.
It's
8:01 anyway.
Yeah.
So what's one more?
Jessica said, don't be afraid to physically stop them, especially kids. I've been lectured for telling a kid no.
Yeah.
Whatever, lady. Teach your kid good dog manners.
Yeah, I have no problem at all.
We've like body blocked kids before because they'll come screaming.
Yeah, I've had to like hold my, I really don't want to physically grab them, but I've definitely held my hand up, and I will do what it takes to keep anybody away from my dogs. But I think a child though, even if your dog is friendly with kids, the fact that the kid ran up to your dog, I think it's important that the child learn proper etiquette.
Yeah, like, just that startle
like
effect.
Just also asking permission.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think it's important because your dog might be friendly, but they might rush up to the wrong dog one day. So on that note, we are going to end the show because it's 8:02. Show goes till 8. We'll be back Wednesday night at 7 p.m. And everybody have a fantastic night, and we'll talk to you later.
Good night.